I'm going to present a work on the adaptive shift in atmosphere in a changing environment, what I have done with the linear model with the HMR, and the Ophiuchus. So biodiversity is currently threatened by rapid environmental challenges, such as climate warming. And this has motivated the development of many empirical studies to try to understand and predict the response of populations to these changes. So one of the classical approach assumes that the fitness of an individual, which is normally distributed in the population, so here in the red, depends on the match between the mean phenotype, between one of the match between the phenotype of the individual and an optimum, depending on the Gaussian fitness function. So the model investigates the change in the mean fit value in the population when the optimum changes linearly with time. So under the first approach that I've used this approach by Lynch and colleague showed that the mean trade value in the population will follow the optimal trade value with an increasing mismatch, which will decrease the mean fitness in the population. So as the optimum changes with time, the mean trade value in population first evolves slowly and then at the same speed as the optimum, and then track the optimum phenotype with a lag. If this lag is too large, the population is going to decline and go extinct. So there is, however, some complicating factor for this prediction. So one of them is that the traits involved in adaptation to climate change, so often technological traits, have antagonistic effects on different fitness components. So here, for example, in Bochera, the trait that maximizes fecundity in yellow is different than the phenology that maximizes survival in blue. And the mean in the population is represented by a little star, a yellow star. So throughout this talk, I'm going to focus on flowering time, but the same kind of trade-off has been documented in birds, for example, when there is an antagonistic effect of precocity flowering date or breeding time on adult survival and immature recruitment. So inspired by this empirical data, we ask here three questions, which are: how conflicting selection pressures across different fitness components affect adaptation lags in the changing environment? How do such lags in adaptation affect life history components and then the life cycle itself in the changing environment? And how feedback loops between evolution and demography will affect population evolutionary response and demography in a changing environment? So to study this question, we developed a model where a single trait, which is here flowering time, have antagonistic effect on different fitness components. So in the model, there is just two stages, immature and mature individual, and flowering time as affects adult survival and adult fecundity. And the optimal flowering time is different for survival and for fecundity. So we used estimated parameter value, beta rates, for this life cycle. So we find that in a constant environment, the mean trade value in the population will evolve to an equilibrium, which is between the optimum for fecundity in blue and the optimum for survival in red. So when we change the maturation rates, we find that the mean phenotypes at equilibrium gets closer to the value maximizing fecundity when the maturation rate is higher. So to understand these results, we can go to the expression for the phenotype at equilibrium, which can be interpreted as an integrative optimal phenotypic value, which is the weighted mean of the optima for survival and fecundity. So the weight, the E, F and ES, correspond to the proportional contribution of the beta rates, which are here fecundity and survival, to the exponential population growth rate. So this quantity is well known from demographers and corresponds to what they call demographic elasticities. So then, going back to the plot, we can so interpret it in the way that when maturity rate is low, individual will stay a long time into the juvenile stage. Many of them will die, and very few will reach the adult reproductive stage, so that reproduction contributes weakly to population growth, and then the elasticity of population growth to fecundity is low. And as maturity rates increase, more and more individuals reach the adult stage, and then reproduction will contribute a lot to population growth. So the weight of the optimum for fecundity gets stronger with increasing maturity rate. So then we investigated the case of a changing climate. So climate warming is known to select for earlier flowering dates. So here we assume that the rate of decline in a flowering date maximizing survival and fecundity is so that both the optima declines at the same rate. So in this case, mean threat value in the population in black will evolve to follow the optimum in green with some lag as we find previously. However, how it does so, the mean threat value in population is going to get farther and farther from the optimum for fecundity and closer to the optimum for survival. So then, with climate warming, fecundity will decrease with time, whereas adult survival will improve. So this corresponds to a shift in life history, and if one look at just that survival, it can be wrongly interpreted as an adaptation to climate change, whereas it is actually a maladaptive shift in life history, corresponding to the fact that the population evolved too slow to track the integrative optimum, which is in between the optimum for survival and fecundity. So the change in life history induced by climate warming actually also induce a positive feedback loop between evolution and demography. So if for a life cycle component, the mismatch between the mean threat value in the population and the optimum for this life history component is large, it will depress this life history component, and it will then depress its contribution to the population growth rate. And then, in turn, it will depress selection on this life history component, which will result in an even larger mismatch between the mean threat value in the population and the optimum for this specific life history. So to explore how this feedback loop affects the prediction, we looked at prediction when we hold the elasticity constant. Therefore, we disrupt this feedback loop. So here, the dashed green and the dashed black lines correspond respectively to the optimum and to the mean threat value in the population when we hold the elasticity constant at their initial value. So what we see here is that the integrative optimum that corresponds to the case where we leave elasticity change is even farther from the optimum maximizing fecundity than the optimum when we keep the elasticity constant, which actually shows that this positive feedback loop pushes selection in the same direction as maladaptation toward the optimum for survival. So the effect of feedback loops is even stronger when we look at the case where the optimal flowering days for fecundity and survival decrease at different rates. So we find two outcomes for the scenario, depending on the exact initial condition. So in the first case, as the population starts to evolve, the mean fate value in the population gets farther and farther from the optimum for survival, which will reduce the contribution of survival to population growth. And then selection turns towards the optimum for fecundity. So that's the mean fate value in the population will track the optimum for fecundity each time with some lag. So in this case, there is a shift from hetero parity to semi-parity, as individuals cannot survive in the adult stage anymore. So the transition from hetero parity to semi-parity, during this transition, there is a transient period where the population is actually declining. But eventually, the population is still viable. In the other case, we find the reverse situation, which is that the mean trait value in the population gets farther and farther from the optimum, for fecundity. So that fecundity contributes less to population growth, and this will push selection toward the optimum for survival. So it results that the mean trait value in the population will go towards the optimum for survival. But in this case, the optimum for this local optimum for survival is not viable, and the population is in a declining state. So in this case, the feedback loop corresponds to meltdown of the life cycle and works as an evolutionary trap, pushing the population toward extinction. So to summarize our results, we find that lag adaptation results in mean phenotype shifting along the trade-off between survival and fecundity. We find that improvement in self-fitness component following climate change may actually correspond to maladaptive response reflecting soil evolution. So even improvement in self-fitness component can announce imminent extinction. So this is reminiscent of recent results from Fiat and Engel showing that demographic compensation does not rescue population facing climate change. We also highlight a positive feedback loop between evolution and demography, which can result in a life cycle meltdown. And this echoes a point made by Osmond and Grossmeyer recently, showing that the strength of selection does not always increase with the distance between the optimum and the mean fate value.